Lord, thank you for Jesus Christ that willingly came and received and died for us, Lord God, for our salvation, for that we may have eternal life. We remember this, O Lord God, that through his death, O Lord God, that we may have life. And as we commemorate our communion today, Lord God, that we, each one, would just come face to face and recognize that, Lord, you are truly the Son of God, that you have, what you have done for us, that we recognize, Lord God, that you're all-powerful and all-forgiving, Lord God. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'd like to ask some of our men who assist us in distribution of the bread and the cups. I'd like to give a few instructions. If you have received Christ and you know that Christ is in your heart, I'd like to invite you to participate in the Lord's Supper, especially those who have been follow the Lord in baptism. We're going to distribute this orderly. If you are on this side, just move front and get the elements from here. If you're on this side, you just move towards the aisle and get your elements from here. After you get the elements, go back to your seats, and we are going to partake the elements together.
Which I receive from the Lord, for which I am delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said,
"Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Let's partake of the bread, which represents the body of Christ.
In the same manner, he took the cup and said,
"This is the new covenant of my blood. This do as often as you drink in remembrance of me."
Let's partake of the cup, which represents the blood of Christ.
"For as often as you eat this bread and drink this from this cup, you will proclaim the Lord's coming."
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we are sinners saved by the grace of God. And it was only possible through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Thank you for dying on the cross for our sins, giving your whole life for us, pouring your own blood to cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. And we give you all the glory and praise for what you have done for us, dear Lord. And even right now, dear Lord, even as we wait for your coming, that we promise to serve you and honor you and glorify you and spread your love throughout this world. Thank you that you have entrusted us with a great commission. And we just pray right now that even as we do this, that our hearts will always long for your coming, because we know that you are coming again because you promised. Bless us now, Lord, and we give you all the glory and praise, for this is our prayer, in Jesus' name, amen. Ask Brother Lucian to lead us in our offertory prayer.
Good afternoon. Please bow your heads. Dear Lord in heaven, at this time, beginning of the new year, we ask, O Lord, that you give us the strength to understand what you want of us. Help us, O Lord, to submit ourselves to your will. And at this time, help us to give us the strength to contribute what you need from us, to understand that what you did for us pales in comparison to what we can offer. Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Ushers, please.
Let's all rise for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son,
remain standing as we read the scripture for today. Maybe open our Bible and open it on James chapter 4, verse 13 through 17. James chapter 4, verse 13 through 17. Let's open our Bibles to James 4, verse 13 to 17, and read along with me. "Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go do this or that city, spend a year there, carry on businesses, and make money. Why? You do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast and brag.
All such boasting is evil. Anyone, then, who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it, sins. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. You may be seated.
Thank you very much, Brother Fidel, for reading our scripture for today. I hope that your Bibles are open, because we're going to meditate on those verses that was read a while ago. And I have entitled my sermon for today, Successful Planning for 2014. I'm sorry, is there a children's church today?
No children's church today.
No children's church today. Let the kids come back. Successful planning for 2014. I know that many of you have probably already looking forward to this year. Some of you may have thought about what to do, things that you want to happen this year. Of course, in our looking ahead, many of us, if not all of us, will hope that this 2014 will be a better year than 2013. We desire to do better in many, many aspects of our life, for example, financially, or physically, health-wise. I will be better this year than last year, socially, and even spiritually, okay? Because our lives compose also of our spirit. So we want to be better this year. And so we want to set goals. We want to write down our plan. Some people would call it a New Year's resolution. You may call it whatever you want, but just have something in mind. You aim at something. One author said, if you aim at nothing, you will surely hit it. Nothing. That's why you have to set goal something. And so I've got some great suggestions for you and even for myself about successful planning for 2014. But first, let's look at what the scripture says. We just heard it a while ago, and we're going to come back to it because I believe that God's wisdom is manifested, is given to us through his word. And so God must be speaking to us, especially right now when we look ahead to this new year. Actually, if you read the first verse of our passage today, it's actually talking about us, okay? It's talking to people who are making plans for today and tomorrow. And that's you and me. In other words, this passage is actually speaking to me, to you. And so assume that God is actually telling you something through this passage. In fact, we can find some essential thoughts that James shared to those people with regards to planning for the future, 2014. So let me share with you three things. Three essential things that we must consider in planning for 2014. Number one is this. Be realistic about your life. Be realistic about your life. Let's look at verse 14 first. And verse 14 says, you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Oh. That verse is really loaded. And especially when you think about your life, it's actually telling us that our life here on earth is short. In fact, it talks about, it illustrates the life that we have here on earth is like a mist. What's a mist? Fog. Or smoke. Huh? Here today, gone tomorrow. That is our life. That the Bible describes it the way it was described here in James. And if we